In this video, we analyze and compare the fault currents provided by the external grid in both AC and DC microgrids. The main learning objectives will fall under three main questions. Firstly, how is the fault current calculated in an AC microgrid connected to an external grid? Secondly, which elements are contributing to the DC fault current of a DC microgrid? Thirdly, what are the differences of the fault currents in AC and DC microgrids? If the fault occurs inside an AC microgrid, which is connected to the external grid, it is likely that a large portion of the fault current is fed by the AC grid. In the figure above, we show the external grid, which is connected through a transformer and a line to the AC microgrid. The equivalent electrical circuit is shown in the figure below, where the grid is represented by a voltage source. The impedance of the line is represented by the resistance R and the inductance L. The amplitude of the impedance Z depends on the resistance R and the reactance, which is equal to omega multiplied by the inductance L. The phase angle theta between the real component, meaning the resistance, and the imaginary component, meaning the inductance, is obtained using the arctangent function. The time constant of the impedance T is calculated dividing the inductance L by the resistance R. If we define the fault current from the grid to the microgrid as IF, then the grid voltage can be formulated by the differential equation. This voltage has the amplitude of Vm, the angular frequency of omega, and the initial phase of alpha. Note that here we do not formulate the fault impedance. If we solve the previous differential equation, the fault current IF is obtained as a function of the voltage amplitude Vm, the amplitude of the impedance Z, the angular speed omega, the initial phase alpha, and the impedance phase angle theta, and the time constant T. This equation represents two different components. The first one is the steady state AC sine wave with the angular speed omega. On top of this, the second component is a DC exponential decay with the time constant T. In the figure below, we show an example of the fault current where the fault is applied at time equal to zero. The exponential decay is shown where the amplitude of the fault current starts to decrease over time. Also, in this example, we show the current amplitude goes up to 2 times of the nominal value that is typically much lower compared to the fault currents at the DC side. Another point to which we pay attention is the presence of 2 zero crossing currents at each fundamental cycle. Typically, the AC breakers are able to detect these zero crossing and then effectively disconnect the breaker at these points. Let's now have a look into the fault current of a DC microgrid, which is connected to an AC grid through the power converters. If the fault occurs at the DC side, then this fault current is provided by various elements, like the grid, the parallel capacitor of the DC link, and the inductor of the DC cables. The equivalent electrical circuit is shown in the figure below. Here we assume that a three-phase, three-leg converter is used to supply the DC side, where the line is represented by the R and the inductance L. During the fault at the DC side, various elements contribute to the fault current. The first evident element is the grid, where the currents of phases A, B, and C are passing through the electrical switches and the freewheeling diodes. In the figure above, we show the simplified equivalent circuit when the grid contributes to the fault. In this case, the grid is represented by a current source shown in green color. In this equivalent circuit, we do not consider the current and voltage of the capacitor, as it is described in the next slide. The second electrical element which contributes to the fault current is the capacitor of the DC link. In the figure above, we show the equivalent circuit of the capacitor. During the fault, the energy stored in the capacitor is released where the fault current is IC. Note that the higher values of the capacitor will typically help increase the stability of the DC link. In other words, the DC link voltage fluctuations can be effectively mitigated by increasing the parallel capacitor of the link. However, during the fault, this causes a very large value of the fault current in DC microgrids that we'll further discuss later in this video. The third contributor to the DC fault current is the discharge of the cable's inductance. During the fault, the inductor releases its stored electrical energy, where the inductor's current will be circulated through the freewheeling diodes of the switches. The equivalent circuit is shown in the figure above, where the current of the inductance passes through the diodes. Note that, obviously, for the fault current component of the cable's inductor, we do not consider the initial voltage of the capacitor. The overall DC fault current, IFDC, can be then obtained summing the grid current component, IG, the capacitor current component, IC, and the DC cable's inductor current component, IL. The figure below shows an example of the DC fault current. As it is shown, the amplitude of this current can reach very high values, for instance, 12 times of the nominal value. This is mainly due to the fact that the inductor of the DC line has a low value compared to the DC resistance. As a result, not only the amplitude of the DC fault current could have a very high value, but also the rate of change of the DC fault current becomes very large. Note that we previously showed that the time constant T depends on the value of inductance L. Thus, for the lower values of the inductance, this time constant is small. That means the very large rate of changes. Besides, as it is visible in the figure, there are no zero crossing points in the DC fault current. This makes the disconnection of the fault by the breakers very difficult in DC microgrids. In this video, we evaluated and compared the fault currents of both AC and DC microgrids. In a DC microgrid, we showed that various elements are able to contribute to the fault current, where the amplitude of the DC fault current is relatively much larger than the AC one. Moreover, we discussed that due to the absence of the zero crossing point in the DC fault currents, they are much more difficult to interrupt. Therefore, our conclusion from this video is that the conventional protection schemes for AC microgrids are likely not to be applicable for DC microgrids, which need much faster and more advanced protection systems.